process of applying to financial aid, or being aware of the resources that might be available to you or your students on entering your college. So first I'm going to start off basically describing the various types of financial aid and what exactly constitutes financial aid. We'll go over the application process and provide you some helpful resources that might help you in the financial aid application process. And then give any questions if time allows, I can go over some of those with you and help you out with those. So first off, what exactly constitutes financial aid? Financial aid effectively is funds made available to a student pay for post-secondary educational expenses. These include scholarships and grants. This is types of financial aid that is not being paid back. You have work study, which is financial aid that's awarded to a student where they work a job and they're paid funds like they get a job and they're paid that directly to their bank account. And you have loans. Loans are financial resources that a student will eventually have to pay back. Terms of these loans vary depending on the type of loan it is. We'll go over those in more detail here shortly. But first I want to talk about the scholarships. So scholarships typically are what's referred to as financial resources that can be paid back. They're awarded by various organizations. So colleges and universities award scholarships through the various elements. For example, the UVA Alumni Association might award a scholarship to a student based upon specific terms. Then you have private community scholarships, such as like the Lions Club, who will award a scholarship to a student based upon their eligibility requirements. These are numerous. Many institutions offer scholarships, most in fact. Then you have lots of private philanthropic organizations that provide scholarships as well. Then grants differ a little bit in terms of scholarships because grants are typically need-based scholarships that are awarded to students. So for example, the University of Virginia Access UVA's are need-based institutional financial aid grant. Other schools will have these from time to time, it really depends on the institution. And again, these something you can pay back at any point if you give it to the student. We have loans. So loans vary in their terms and who awards them. You have federal student loans, which include the federal direct loans, which can be both subsidized and unsubsidized. And interest rates vary based upon when the loans are originated. So what the loans might be in the coming year will be set by Congress sometime this summer. The annual maximum for a first-year student is $5,500. In addition to the federal direct loans, there's also the federal Perkins loan, which is offered by some institutions, and they set their eligibility requirements for those as well. You have federal Parent Plus loans. These are non-need-based loans that a parent or student will apply for. It's borrowed on behalf of the student, but it's the parent borrowed, so it's in the parent's name. These interest rates are usually a little bit higher, but like federal direct loans, they're set by Congress every summer. With these, a credit check is usually required, so that's another part of the process of applying for a plus loan. And again, those are non-need-based, those can be used to borrow up to the cost of the attending an institution. You have private student loans. This is where the student is a borrower. Oftentimes, it requires a parent or someone who's creditworthy to co-sign for those loans, but is in the student's name. Again, similarly, this requires a credit check often. And again, at some point, these typically appear paid absent some extraneous circumstances, but these are supposed to be paid back. And again, work study. Work study is an e-based award that's provided the opportunity for students to work while they're in school, get some experience, have an opportunity to kind of mitigate some of their educational costs while attending an institution. Various schools have different requirements for how this is done and how to meet these jobs, so it's best to check with the schools you're applying to see how much and how you qualify. So that brings us to the application process. So I'm kind of going to give you a high-level overview of how the financial aid application process works and what things you should be aware of when you're applying for financial aid. For many people, this starts with completing the FAFSA. So this is the free application for federal student aid. It's completely CASPA.gov. You can also do it by paper and via regular mail. That's usually more of the process. And basically, what you will do is you go onto the federal applications website and complete it. It's going to ask you various information such as income, assets, household size, number of college, things of that nature. To basically, what it's going to do is spit out the expected income contribution. And I'll get to that a little bit later. Some schools require what's called a CSS profile. This is made available October 1st, so after that, the student can complete that. And that's kind of similar to the FAFSA in terms of it's asking income questions, household size questions, things of that nature, just to get a more comprehensive view. Only certain schools require this, so when applying to schools, check and see if they require it, and if so, check when it's due. And some schools will also require entering students to submit tax documents. So when you complete the FAFSA and the CSS profile, if necessary, also check and make sure whether or not the school wants you to submit tax documents to them at some point. And you just have a screenshot of the FAFSA website. You just go to the Start a New FAFSA link and go from there and enter that with the most accurate information you can provide. Here's just a screenshot of the CSS profile. You just click on the link to apply now. That's available through the College Board's website, which is collegeboard.org. And again, just be conscious of any deadlines that some schools may have for that. Other application requirements. Again, financial aid on the institutional side is really a case-by-case basis as to what some schools will offer you. So just be very conscious of that when applying to schools to make sure you know what they're going to be. For some students, they might find they're selected for what's called federal verification by the Department of Education, which is a process by which the government requires schools and financial offices to confirm the information according to the FAFSA. So if that happens to your student, they'll more than likely be requested to either submit tax returns transcripts for themselves and their parents both filed, and or do the IRS data retrieval tool, which is a tool that's built into the FAFSA that allows parents to upload their tax documents, their tax information directly from the IRS website to the FAFSA, so it takes up the middleman and ensures the information is accurate as possible. So determining financial need. So after you've done the FAFSA, if required, and you've done the CSS profile or any other institution application, a school will go about determining your student's expected income contribution. So the expected income contribution is a calculation of all information you plug in that basically thinks that according to this formula, this is how much your family can provide for your student's education for 1 year. So schools will use that EFC to compare it to the cost of attendance. So you take the average cost of attendance at whatever institution your student's applying to, and they subtract from that the expected income contribution, and that comes out with your student's gives you financial needs. And that is the basis for which financial aid is ultimately awarded its need as financial aid. So I just want to give you some helpful resources in applying for financial aid that you probably may take a look at in this whole process. So the FAFSA.gov, that's where you go to do the FAFSA. Federal Student Aid, that is the part of the Department of Education's website where if your student decides to accept their loans, they need to go there to complete a master promissory note, which is basically a promise of saying that they will repay these loans at some point, and do entrance counseling, which is basically a process by which the program walks a student through what the terms of the loan are, what repayment will look like, and just kind of inform them of the decision. The College Board website, again, that's where you go to complete the CSS profile if required by the schools that your students are applying to. And then you have what's also called the Net Price Calculator. So the Net Price Calculator is really a nifty tool that's available. The federal government requires that all schools have this if they're receiving federal financial aid. So basically, it's a tool by which you can plug in the information that's going to be requested in the FAFSA, possibly on the institutional application, into this calculator, and assuming that you enter the information as accurately as possible, it can give you a kind of an expectation of what financial aid you might be receiving at the schools you're applying to. And I did have a caution that the information that we get as a result of the price calculator is only as good as the information you put in. So if you put in the information that's wildly disparate from your actual the actual numbers, then the result you get might not be as accurate as you might like. So just be really careful if you do use that tool, just to take it with a grain of salt and enter as well as you can. Here's a screenshot. This is the University of Virginia's net price calculator, what the byproduct is. It varies by school. There's not any standard result that you see. But generally speaking, you'll see a breakdown of the estimated cost of attendance for the student based upon in-state versus out-of-state or things of that nature, and then kind of give you an estimation of what financial aid that might be available to your student. Again, take it with a grain of salt. It's ultimately the determination we need once the FAFSA any of their application requirements are looked at and your students are awarded. Here are the resources. A lot of these are ones that really aren't as beneficial if your students just now get into college. EPEP, or Virginia Education Savings Trust, if you haven't already gotten these in subsequent years, it's kind of hard, too late to take those out now. But if your student does have some of these, Education Savings Trust in their name now, that can be a resource going forward to pay for their education. Other states besides BPEP, other programs other than BPEP and BEST are provided by some other states, so if you move here from another state, you might have an educational trust available for your student. And then some universities and colleges provide payment plans for kind of mitigating the lump sum payment you might have to make a student in your college, so you can make a monthly payment. It really depends on the institution and how exactly that works, but it's a bit of a resource that's available to some people. Here's kind of a visual representation of how this whole thing works. When determining how much you will pay for college, you have to take into account the work study, if it's available to you, scholarships available to you, loans and grants, in conjunction with expected income contribution, because the federal government believes that these are the five resources available to a student to pay for college, that you kind of have to take a holistic view and reach for all these things when paying for college. Just a few useful tips applying this process. It's by no means all encompassing, but these are the kind of the key things. Pay close attention to deadlines. Like I said, some universities have deadlines for the institutional financial aid. For example, the University of Virginia has a March 1st deadline by which a student must have completed the FAFSA and the CSS profile in order to be considered for institutional financial aid. Other schools have deadlines that may or may not be the same as that, but just be careful to make sure that you're meeting those deadlines. If you can, use the IRS name retrieval tool. Like I said, it might expedite the process if your students like for verification. And it also will provide a more accurate expected income contribution as well. Take advantage of the school's net price calculators. Like I said, all schools must have these if they're receiving federal financial aid. So again, enter information as accurately as possible and use that as a tool to kind of get a good picture of what financial aid might be available to your student. Again, just continually look for scholarship opportunities. There's tons of them out there. They vary in nature in terms of how much they're available, what the requirements are to get them, deadlines. There's tons of them out there. The internet's a great resource to look for some of these. Just do your due diligence and have your student do their due diligence to get all the scholarships they can possibly get to kind of mitigate the cost of going to college. And if anyone has any questions, now feel free to talk with us.
So,
yes. The FAFSA and the CSS profile need to be completed by March 1st to be considered for institutional financial aid at the University of Virginia.
And also, for the scholarships and grants,
yes. Yeah, so.
What are the determining factors for scholarships and grants?
So, it's a grant. So, grants at the University of Virginia, the Access UVA grant, the need-based grant, That is taken into account when looking at the expected minimum contribution and the cost of attendance. So when you calculate how much a student is eligible for, there's other scholarships offered at the University of Virginia or other universities that are non-need-based grants that don't necessarily look into account how much financial need a student has, but rather their merit, which are commonly called merit scholarships. So those don't take into account that, but need-based grants such as Access to EA or what other schools offer do take into account that.
A question about FAFSA and base year. Can you explain that a little bit? We have a junior and a senior. Mm-hmm. We're wondering if that base year thing changes.
Okay, so basically, if you have a junior and a senior, yeah. Both in high school. Okay, so when your senior student's applying financially with us upcoming fall, so when that's when you're starting, the base year for which the tax information is being evaluated will be 2014.
Right.
But it's called the 2015-2016 FAFSA. It's reflecting your household information for 2015-2016. So when your other student enters college, assuming it's next fall, that would be using the base year 2015 tax information. It would be 2016-2017 FAFSA. And your other student would presumably be a junior or a sophomore at that point. They would also complete the FAFSA with the 2015 tax base year.
So it's a rolling thing as you're going through, you have a new base year each time?
Yeah, there's a chance that going forward, the federal government might try to use what's called prior year data, which is 2 years in the past. It remains to be seen if that will happen or when that will happen. But if it does, it'll be made known to you in the FAFSA. But the biggest takeaway is that every year, if you'll be considered for federal financial aid, you must do the FAFSA each year. That I couldn't tell you. Our office principally deals with the need-based financial aid. I know a lot of private schools do tuition discounting, which is a little more prevalent because they're more expensive. Merit scholarship, I really think it would depend on how prestigious that university is and how competitive it is. I think that's the biggest factor, I would say. But tuition discounting is something that's commonly done at private schools to reduce that net price.
I figured on early admission on the finding, but that would be before January 1, looking at financial aid. What's your recommendation on trying to use it just using that calculator?
That, like I said, since it's before January 1st, that would probably be your best option. If the acceptance is offered to your student and they're being offered merit scholarships, that's something to take into account. But yeah, I think you're right that for some people, they're not going to see their financial aid package until after that that deadline passed. So net price calculator is probably your best bet for that. And possibly talking to someone at institution just to kind of get an understanding of how they work. Because it varies by institution, but institutional financial aid. The federal financial aid presumably is done the same way by all schools as it should be, it's using the federal formula, but institutions have their own eligibility requirements for their institutional aid, so that is something I would talk to you about that particular school.
You had said that the tuition discount.
Yeah.
Primarily the
Yeah.
There's a lot of those posted tuitions, kind of like the rates in the back of that hotel door.
Yes. Now I'm probably only working financially in the state school, but I do have enough knowledge to know that the advertised sticker prices for a lot of private schools are fungible. It sometimes depends on how much need that person has. They might discount to make it more affordable for a student. Private schools have a lot more discretion in terms of how much they charge students, so it could be they know the right person. But in state schools, it's typically a set tuition and be based upon credit hours and things of that nature that is not fungible, but the amount of financial aid offered is based upon need. But yes, they're commonly called the sticker price, which is not always right. Just when you go to a car dealership, it advertises price you can haggle down in some ways. Yes? Other questions? All right, well, I appreciate you all for coming on here and letting me rant off to you about financial aid. But yeah, if you have any questions, specifically about UVA especially, feel free to reach us out to us or contact information. Like I said, just be cognizant of deadlines. And don't hesitate to reach out to any school your students applying to, even if it's not the University of Virginia, because it could be instrumental in your student getting the right financial aid bill for them. So yeah, be proactive.
Can you accept a or they make an offer for acceptance? Can you say yes, contingent on?
So typically, again, it varies by institution. So at the University of Virginia, there is a, I believe it's an April 1st admissions decision deadline check the school's admissions date requirement. And some schools require students to pay admissions deposit. And it's only binding in the sense that you're not getting your money back, and that's not good. But as far as I know, at least at the University of Virginia, I don't know of any, I accept contingent upon financial aid awards. I know if a student applies to financial aid at the University of Virginia, and they complete all the application requirements, and assuming we're not tragically backlogged with work, then they usually see their financial aid award before the commitment deadline.
So the financial aid is part of the application?
Okay, so students completing their separate admissions application,
right,
and they can start going if they're applying, for example, University of Virginia, do this gets us profile between October 1st and whenever, and the FAFSA between January 1st and March 1st before the deadline. And presumably, if there's no other information required, then the award the student financial aid, you need more information, we request that. But typically, we try to do our best to give students a financial award before we commit the deadline for regular admissions. For early admissions, it's not always the case, but we do our best to do that as well. All right, well, thank you very much for having me.